Friday. Goliath returns to a special Knight Rider as Michael faces a double dose of evil.
Last night has escaped from prison.
We meet again.
The lives of April and Devon hang in the balance as the rematch of the century leaps to the ultimate showdown.
Goliath is invulnerable.
Can Kit survive this special two-hour Knight Rider?
Coming up next on the Channel 5 News at 10, Jesse Jackson makes a campaign stop in Gary, Indiana. President Reagan witnesses the initialing of a nuclear accord between the United States and China. And today is Mayor Washington's anniversary in office. Carol Marine will begin a special report on his first year.
In my commentary tonight, some questions about the mayor's reaction to the court-ordered hiring freeze.
And we have a tornado watch in effect until 2 a.m. for the entire area.
On Sports Sunday, big day for the Cubs and the Sox, and we'll take a look at the Bears' strategy for the upcoming NFL draft.
We'll have those stories and more coming up right now on the Channel 5 News at 10.
Of course, I'm known for Chariots of Fire, but I'd rather be known for myself. That's why I just got the American Express card. Shouldn't you apply?
An alcoholic's life is spent thinking entirely of two things: when and how much. When can I have a drink and how much can I drink? And when finally comes, how much is never enough. And they call that living? Don't be a dope.
Anais, Anais. The tender essence of a woman's dream. And now, the enchantment of Anais continues with L'essence de fleur, a romantic accent, the Anais scarf. Wear it with a splash of Anais from the accompanying 1 ounce eau de toilette, a charming duet in a keepsake coffre. Yours for only $10 with any $12.50 Anais purchase.
Each year, people spend millions of dollars to ship pounds and pounds of air. That's because they're charged for a 2-pound envelope, even though they're only sending 1 pound. Isn't there a better way? Introducing the new Emery 1-pound urgent pouch. Stop paying 50% more than you have to. Call Emery, the air delivery service that charges you for the delivery, not the air.
Explore the mysteries of the ocean at Our World Underwater, May 4th through the 6th. Live on Channel 5, this is the 10 o'clock news with Deborah Norville.
Good evening. The state of Illinois is once again being besieged by severe weather, tornadoes, storms. Jerry Taft is here with the latest on the tornado watch for our area. Jerry?
Well, Deborah, right now we do have a tornado watch for all of northeastern Illinois. We've had quite a few tornadoes spotted in central and western Illinois. A touchdown in a small town, Carmen, Illinois, which is in Henderson County, which is in the western part of the state. The line of severe thunderstorms is headed in our direction, so we do expect to see thunderstorms. Whether or not we actually get severe weather still remains to be seen, although up around Crystal Lake, we now have winds reported at 60 miles per hour. You can see the most severe storms are still quite a ways out to the west of us, right along the Mississippi River. The last batch passed to the north of Rockford up toward Milwaukee, as you can see on your screen right there. Later on in the broadcast, we'll update the radar once again and hopefully get rid of these storms during the day tomorrow.
All right, Jerry, thank you. In Mannford, Oklahoma, one person is dead tonight and 50 others injured after a tornado struck four churches during morning services. A twister destroyed a six-block area in Mannford. Dozens of cars in the church parking lot were picked up by the storm and smashed down on top of each other. Parishioners only had a 3 to 5 minute warning for safety.
Hey, please knock that road out over there before it gets somebody.
The twisters also battered the nearby town of Prue, where 30 people were injured. This was the second fatal bout of violent spring weather to hit Oklahoma in 4 days. Weather also caused problems for the Jesse Jackson campaign, as he was 4 hours late for a scheduled appearance. But Jackson is in Gary, Indiana tonight. That state has its primary 1 week from this Tuesday. Otis Buchanan has more.
Following a weather delay of nearly 4 hours, Democratic presidential candidate Jesse Jackson arrived at the Gary airport this evening, obviously weary from a presidential campaign that has reached the halfway point. Just the same, Reverend Jackson told his small airport audience that the Rainbow Coalition's presidential drive is reaching full maturity. On the world scene, Jackson told his supporters President Reagan's travel in China is a step in the right direction.
The rhetoric about communism, the fact that this nation would expand trade relations with China, is a healthy sign. It represents a measure of maturity for Ronald Reagan, who's expanding his worldview. But just as we must relate to China, and that's a step in the right direction, we must relate to the Soviet Union as well.
A short time later, Reverend Jackson arrived in downtown Gary for a rally sponsored by Baptist ministers. And from here, it's on to Memphis, Tennessee, later tonight for another campaign rally. From Gary, I'm Otis Buchanan, Channel 5 News.
Meantime, polls tonight indicate Walter Mondale has an edge over challenger Gary Hart in Tuesday's Tennessee primary. Mondale has garnered support from that state's Democratic Party leaders, and predictions of a light voter turnout could work against the Hart campaign. Gary Hart was in Texas today in preparations for that state's caucuses next Saturday. During a speech in El Paso, Hart said he favored amnesty for illegal aliens who came to this country many years ago and have settled down here. There are 169 delegates at stake in Texas. It is already Monday in China, and President and Mrs. Reagan are visiting Shanghai. Earlier today in Peking, Mr. Reagan witnessed the initialing of a nuclear cooperation pact with China, which will be signed later. The only tourist break for the Reagans came Sunday there, when they flew to the ancient city of Xi'an. There they saw one of the world's archaeological wonders, 2,000-year-old statues of soldiers guarding the tomb of China's first emperor. The president wanted to visit a typical village, but instead, Chinese officials brought a village to him, complete with muck market.
Mr. President, what does this tell you about capitalism in China?
This is flourishing.
Is capitalism the way for the future here?
Ask the Chinese.
Why don't you buy something?
Ask them.
We're going to.
What are you going to buy?
Something for the Christmas tree.
The Reagans will be back in this country on Wednesday. Border police in Texas tonight are still investigating the deaths of four illegal aliens last night. One woman and three children, part of a group of illegal aliens, were struck by a train as they walked on a railroad trestle near Kingsville. Officials say the rest of the group was able to jump 31 feet into this shallow creek. At least seven people were injured. The train engineer said he didn't see the group in time to stop. Israeli police have taken into custody 35 Jews, some of them American-born Israelis, for suspected membership in an anti-Arab terrorist underground. Security sources in Jerusalem say the group is believed involved in an attempt to blow up Arab buses. Among those taken were leaders of Jewish settlement movements, high-ranking Reserve Army officers, including one on active duty. And the sounds of sirens in Israel today signaled 2 minutes of silence throughout that Jewish nation. It was in remembrance for the 6 million Jews who died in Nazi concentration camps. Here in Illinois and Chicago, Governor Thompson and Mayor Washington declared this week as Holocaust Week. Diane Lawson attended one of the services in our area today.
It is a history lesson for the young, a day to help them understand what happened 40 years ago, to make them realize the horror the Nazis created. Candles were lit at Temple Shari Tikva for the 6 million victims of the camps, the soldiers who fought the Nazis, and the children who survived.
Today is my happiest day when I was liberated from Dachau, from the American army. It was coming out in the same day, 1945, April 29.
Maya Berenberg is concerned about the future and wonders who will remember the past.
I think the young people, our children, should do more than we will be not here. Then they should really continue the memorial, the services.
Her daughter agrees education is needed.
Well, I went to a national college and I also went to law school, and it amazes me that people that are that educated know very little about Jewish people in general and also practically nothing about the Holocaust.
A monument is being built in the village of Skokie as a reminder, not just to the Jewish community, but the world at large, of how many people suffered. But those who lived through it need no physical reminders of the Holocaust. Their pain is real enough. Diane Lawson, Channel 5 News.
Still ahead, a coalition of white residents say they're dissatisfied with Mayor Washington, and Carol Marine will begin an exclusive report on Washington's first year in office.
groceries in these bags cost $87. It's about what the average family spends in a week. It's also what the average suburban commuter wastes every month by driving. $87 every month. I'm John Kramer, chairman of the RTA. We have new lower rail fares and a new monthly bus and rail ticket that can save you that $87. It's the new RTA link-up ticket, on sale now at downtown and most suburban rail stations. So link up with the RTA and save.
If you don't run a giant corporation, most downtown bankers treat you like, what's in this bag? That's their bag, it's not ours. At Citizens Bank, mid-sized companies are our big business. We don't think anyone who runs a successful company deserves to be treated like small potatoes. With the largest lending limit outside the city, we're Citizens Bank, the big business bank in the suburbs. At Citizens Bank, you're this, not this.
Barbra Streisand, James Taylor, Barry Manilow, Fleetwood Mac, Billy Joel, Radar Weather, Johnny Mathis, Dionne Warwick, Concise News, Neil Diamond, The Beatles, Clear Traffic Watch, Frank Sinatra, Chicago. Your music is moving easy on WCLR 102 FM.
Question. Can you name the number one selling car in America today? That was easy. Now can you name two other top-selling American cars? Right. Now name the American cars that traditionally retain higher trade-in values than any other cars in their class, year after year. Final question. Name the place you'll find these wonderful cars and the deals all Chicagoland loves. At your Gallant Man of
Oats. About 1,000 members of an organization dissatisfied with Mayor Washington's leadership held a convention today at a downtown hotel. The group is called Save Our Neighborhoods, Save Our City, and it's composed primarily of white residents of the Northwest and Southwest sides. The delegates met to set a so-called ethnic agenda for Chicago, and speakers decried what they called the polarization of our city.
We are disturbed when we hear that there is a great clash in this city between the conservative Northwest and Southwest sides and the reformist progressive sectors, suggesting that we are an enemy to be trodden and vanquished and not treated as equal partners partaking in the rewards of Chicago.
In its publication, the coalition charges that Mayor Washington is banking on white flight from Chicago to enhance his chances for re-election. Today marks the end of Harold Washington's first year as mayor, and according to a Channel 5 Sun-Times poll, nearly half the white population of the city and one-third of the blacks say things have gotten worse here during those 12 months. But most people are optimistic about improvement over the next 3 years of the mayor's term. In specific areas, such as maintaining police, fire, transportation, and streets and sanitation services, Chicagoans overall think Washington's done a pretty good job. Blacks tend to give the mayor his highest marks, two-thirds calling his work here good to excellent. Almost the same number of whites thought city services under the mayor were only fair to poor. On the 1992 World's Fair, which now appears to be on track after weeks of indecisive negotiations between the governor, the mayor, and city council officials, Washington got only a lukewarm endorsement. Nearly half of all Chicagoans called the mayor's handling of city negotiations fair to poor. Black voters again gave the mayor good marks, while whites were more critical. Nearly one-third cited his efforts as poor. And all groups took the mayor to task on the status of the Chicago Housing Authority, whose residents somehow survived a winter of frozen water pipes, lack of heat, broken down elevators, and the questionable stewardship of Washington appointee Renault Robinson. The horror stories of the CHA's winter did not go unnoticed. Nearly 60% of all Chicagoans, blacks and whites, gave the mayor a negative rating when asked about the CHA. Only a third of black voters, a group which normally supports the mayor enthusiastically, thought that the mayor done a good job here. Our Channel 5 Sun-Times poll was conducted by the Gallup organization, which interviewed over 1,000 Chicago residents by telephone from April 18th to April 21st. It has a plus or minus 4 percentage point margin of error. Tomorrow night, the mayor's image as a reformer and the city's racial climate. For a look at some of the shortcomings and accomplishments of the Washington administration's first year, Carol Marine has this special report.
I, Harold Washington, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
In the 1 year since he took the oath of office, Harold Washington has radically changed the nature of Chicago government and politics. The question at hand is whether that change has been for better or for worse.
Clearly, he's opened up government. Government is far more open now than it has ever been.
I see it as an outright failure as far as the white ethnic communities are concerned.
I think that the mayor has done a good job. It certainly is not a job that is completed.
Jane Byrne had her favorite Latinos, and Washington has his favorite Latinos.
His first year in office has been marked with a preoccupation with politics.
I would grade him highly in terms of what he's attempted to do.
In order to assess what we've done, you've really got to take a hard look at what we inherited, and I'm not so certain that's going to be easy.
A year ago, Harold Washington, the candidate, campaigned that something had to be done.
Chicago is, in 1983, is in a serious crisis. Our citizens are leaving. Unemployment has reached unprecedented levels. Our industrial base, sewers, streets, mass transportation has deteriorated. Jobs are controlled by political patronage, insidious and invidious. Avarice, dishonesty, and intrigue are dominant characteristics of Chicago's government.
So what's changed in a year? Harold Washington would say a lot has, including patronage, which he claims is now dead, although some of his critics disagree. As far as industry and jobs and people leaving the city, a year later, they're still leaving the city. But that exodus didn't begin with the Washington administration. It started earlier. And as far as ridding city government of avarice and dishonesty and intrigue, there are people on either side of the aisle in city council who would answer to that fat chance.
So if you shut up, Bernie, and listen to somebody else.
And so it will amaze no one that there is a debate in this city over just how well the mayor has done in his first year, a year preceded by a number of campaign promises. Harold Washington promised to cut the city budget, and he did, by about $60 million. He promised to cut the city workforce, and he has, by about 3,500. He pledged to increase state and not city taxes. However, city taxes coupled with user fees have gone up by $100 million under his administration. He promised to appoint a black to head the Chicago Housing Authority. He did, but honoring that promise created as many problems as it solved. And one of the mayor's principal pledges dealt with a time-honored Chicago tradition.
We will end, absolutely end, totally, completely kaput every vestige of patronage in the city.
A lot of people within the Latino community just feel that the patronage system has changed color, but has not died.
Absolutely untrue. We have the equivalent of a deputy mayor in Ben Reyes.
The decision-making apparatus or jobs are roughly 45% white, 40% black, and the balance Hispanic and Asian.
Latinos in general do not find the doors open to employment, and I don't mean just a couple of positions at the top, I mean just general employment.
Virginia Martinez of the Latino Institute is not the only Hispanic to make that complaint, but the mayor maintains a severe obstacle to hiring middle and lower level people in government is the Shachtman decree. The irony of that is Shachtman is a reform mandate against patronage. If some Hispanics are critical of the mayor's first year, so too are some business leaders, according to Frank Coakley of the Civic Federation.
We've just finished examining the mayor's 22-bill legislative package, and it reads anti-business. It is rife with disincentives to business. There are tax increases on virtually every conceivable variety in that package.
I've never heard the Civic Federation say anything else.
State Senator Richard Newhouse is one of the many who defend the mayor's search for new tax options as absolutely necessary, further arguing Harold Washington has not in his first year been anti-business at all.
I think the mayor has caused an atmosphere to be present in white ethnic neighborhoods, especially on the northwest and the southwest side, that have given people fear. They have no confidence.
The neighborhoods present a different area of assessment and in some cases criticism for the administration. Jean Mayer is a prominent Southwest Side community leader who is currently at the forefront of a new coalition called Save Our City. It's a white ethnic coalition of neighborhoods that did not vote for Harold Washington, a coalition that argues now their neighborhoods are being penalized for that with more low-income housing and less community development money.
We can just list a number of things we've done in the northwest and southwest sectors of the city, including visibility, almost to the ubiquitous degree. I think there may be some guilt feelings there and an assumption that I would be vindictive. If you look at this economic development programs which are going on, the northwest and the southwest section have had more than their fair share of initiatives coming not from their aldermen, but from this mayor. It just is not true.
As Mayor, Harold Washington has been a man in a spotlight for the last year, and he knows his first year in office has received a full range of grades, depending on who was doing the grading and what the issue was. As for the mayor himself, he offers his own assessment.
A plus for effort, B plus for achievement, triple A for optimism.
In the last analysis, no matter what marks you give the Washington administration for its first year, it is impossible to grade government in isolation from politics. The two are inextricably linked. And this year, in the highly charged and polarized political climate, it was often the case that politics interfered with government. Tomorrow night at 10 o'clock, we'll take a look at the politics of the Washington administration, both the politics of power and the politics of race. Carol Marine, Channel 5 News.
Coming up, the mayor's fight against a hiring freeze surprises Dick Kay. He'll have a commentary. And Jerry Taft will have the latest on this threatening weather. Stay with us.
Grab, 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 grabby, grabby, pulley, draggy, scrape, scrape, scrape.
Don't worry, call the CarX man.
At CarX, we do brakes the way they should be done, carefully. Disc brakes, drum brakes, foreign cars, American cars. We've got the equipment and the know-how to do the job right. So when your brakes go bad, come into CarX. Slowly, slowly.
Grabby, grabby, pulley, draggy, scrape, scrape, scrape.
Don't worry, call the CarX man.
Dive into a fabulous fantasy weekend at the beautiful Mart Plaza atop the Apparel Center.
Welcome. Your complimentary champagne is being chilled.
Your room will be the finest we have available. Just $79.95 per couple. Stay a second night for only $30 and park free. We'll give you 25 fantasy dollars for food or drink at any of the Mart Plaza's fine places for gourmet or casual dining. For fantasy weekend reservations, call 836-5000.
I see by your resume you're applying for the job as our office copier.
Gentlemen, meet the meter 312, RE copier.
You don't mind if we just see what you can do?
He's fast, 30 copies a minute.
He reduces, enlarges copies on two sides.
There's a feeder.
Sorter. And a self-diagnostic control system.
He's got everything we need, but I bet he'll cost us. Is that all? So, when did you say you could start?
Ask your meter man.
Meter, full-service copiers.
Return with us to those thrilling prices of yesteryear. The Chicagoland Northern Indiana AMC Jeep Renault 10th Sessional Spring Sale. All cars on sale, none held back. One price only, the lowest possible. Alliances, Encores, Cherokees, Wagoneers, and Fuegos. Indiana location this Thursday, Friday, and Saturday at the Hammond Civic Center. Southside location this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at Greater Chicago Auto Auction, 120th and Cicero. North and West Side location this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at the O'Hare Expo Center, River Road, directly across from the O'Hare Hyatt Regency. Don't you dare miss this sale.
Mayor Washington's administration plans to appeal a hiring freeze imposed on the city by a federal judge. And that surprises Dick Kay, who's here now with his commentary. Dick?
Whoa. Wait a minute, Mayor Washington. Did I hear you correctly? When federal judge Nicholas Bua imposed a hiring freeze on the city last Thursday, did you really say the freeze was a flagrant intrusion into your authority to run the city? Mayor, did you really say the court ban on city hiring is radically incorrect? Mayor, I don't understand that. I thought the city already had a ban on hiring. I thought you imposed the freeze the day you took office a year ago. A few days after you took office, May 5th, 1983, this press release on city financial problems said, and we quote, Mayor Washington noted he had ordered a hiring freeze. In a television speech to Chicago on July 25th last year, Mayor, you said you had instituted actions to save money, and you said, quote, they include a freeze on city hiring. When you announced your preliminary budget last August, Mr. Mayor, your news release said the budget, quote, projects no addition to the present city workforce. Now, Mayor Washington, you who have been telling us for a year that you had a hiring freeze in effect,
You are going to appeal Judge Bua's freeze on hiring? As I said, I don't understand. Why appeal Judge Bua's freeze when I find no record of your ever telling us you had lifted your own hiring freeze? Could it be, Mayor Washington, that you have been hiring political allies while telling us there was a freeze? For a long time, you've been telling us patronage is dead and government is open. But frankly, Your Honor, with your fight against this court freeze on political hiring, I'm troubled that there might be some things you haven't been telling us. And I'm Dick Kay.
All right, Dave, thank you. Jerry Taft's here now with the weather. A little while ago, you were saying 60-mile-an-hour winds up in Crystal Lake.
That's right, and we've also had some pea-sized hail. So far in northern Illinois, northeastern Illinois, we've had no funnel clouds or tornadoes reported, although down in central and western Illinois, they've had them most of the evening. We'll take a look at radar here in just a second. Kind of interesting, during the day, we had a high temperature of only 60. The high has now jumped up to 70 degrees as the winds have switched around to the south. We will see the winds come around to the west by tomorrow morning, and we'll actually drop into the 50s by about rush hour tomorrow. The rain so far out at O'Hare is only 0.19. Before I get to the rain, because there's rain all over the place, it's interesting to note that it's cold enough in portions of Iowa and northwestern Wisconsin to be getting snow. You can see temperatures in the 30s out there, in the 50s, 60s, and as I mentioned now, even jumping up to 70 degrees officially at O'Hare. Here's a look at the radar. Earlier tonight, we did have a touchdown in Carmen, a small town in Henderson County between Moline and Burlington, Iowa. That was with this first group of storms that are now coming through Chicago. Although we do have heavy rain and high winds with these right now, no severe weather. But this line of storms that is continuing to move to the east-northeast is the one that I'm worried about. So the far northern counties, McHenry, Lake, and from DeKalb north, should be on the lookout later on tonight. The official reading now at O'Hare, 70 degrees, and it's pretty humid too with humidity, 66%, a little bit cooler at the lake, and the wind south at 26 miles an hour. Tonight there is a tornado watch until 2 a.m. for all the counties that are watching the broadcast right now. Showers and thunderstorms are prevalent through the area, and we can expect to see the assemblance of severe weather in most locations, at least the wind, the possibility of hail, and a tornado watch means that our conditions are favorable for the development of tornadoes. For the rest of the week, it's going to be rather cool, and we do have a chance again for some rain showers developing toward the end of the week, about Friday. Now you can see a very intense storm now moving into Missouri, warm, moist air in on one side, cold air down on the other, and it's cold enough to be causing snow, as I mentioned, from Nebraska all the way up to Minnesota, northwestern Wisconsin, and warm, obviously, for showers and thunderstorms on this time. 4 to 10 inches of snow today in portions of Nebraska. We don't expect to see any snow here in Chicago. Watches and warnings now exist from Arkansas all the way up to Chicago. You can see the heaviest storms are well to the south of us, but there's also some out to the west that I showed you on radar that could have an effect here later on tonight. Tomorrow, we'll see the rain move off during the morning. We will stay cloudy throughout the day. Eventually, we'll get some sunshine on Tuesday. And it will get cooler tomorrow. As the winds come around to the west, it'll only be in the 50s compared to the 70-degree reading that we have right now. So tomorrow, cloudy, windy, cool, morning showers moving off, high of only 58 degrees during the day tomorrow, 60 on Tuesday, 57 Wednesday, 55 Thursday, and another chance of rain toward the end of the week. So temperatures averaging out below normal for the next 5 days.
Okay, but tornado watch until 2 o'clock this morning.
Until 2 a.m.
All right, thanks, Jerry. No deaths were reported in a strong earthquake which rocked central Italy this morning. Officials say the tremor was centered about 90 miles northeast of Rome. About 100 people were injured and more than 2,500 were left homeless. Hundreds of buildings in the area were also damaged. And after 15 years of construction delays and anti-nuclear protests, California's Diablo Canyon nuclear power plant was started up this weekend. But within hours, the plant reported its first problem to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. An open valve allowed slightly radioactive water to flow into a tank where it wasn't supposed to go. But officials say it was an unusual event and it posed no danger. Up next, Mark Giangreco with a preview of what's ahead on Sports Sunday. And a Southwest side man has a stroke of both good and bad luck.
Engine heat, high RPMs. Make today's smaller, harder working engines run hot like these racers. And for protection, there's new Amoco Ultimate 100% synthetic motor oil. Look how Ultimate resists high heat on this engine cylinder wall. Premium oil thickens, loses its protection, but Ultimate keeps flowing and lubricating. Ultimate helps engines last longer.
There's something special about the Holmes Coldwell Banker cells.
Is this us?
This is us. This home is us.
Still love it?
You helped us make the dream come true, to live the way we wanted to. You brought us home.
As part of the Sears Financial Network, Coldwell Banker Real Estate can bring you home.
The homes that make us say, that's us.
Write your own deal on a special Ford Crown Victoria. Manufacturer's suggested retail price is $14,699, but during this event, you buy this Crown Victoria for about $13,211. This average survey price, including a special option package, means you could save $1,488 and get air, speed control, premium sound system, and more. Save over $1,400 on this loaded Crown Victoria. No reasonable offer will be refused when you write your own deal at your Ford dealer now. Police tonight are telling a 20-year-old Southwest Side man that his chances are good of recovering a $100,000 lottery ticket that was taken from him at gunpoint. Nasser Nasser bought his jackpot winning ticket at the store where he works on Friday night. With the ticket hidden in his shoe, Nasser took the bus home, a 45-block ride, with two men he believed were following him. Aided by four other men, the pair robbed him.
Gun on my hand, and you know, pull the triggers, and I say, hey, that's your last chance. We'll still shoot you and take your tickets. That's a lot of money for me.
Police say tonight that they will arrest anyone trying to cash that stolen ticket. And while we're on the subject of money, the Arthritis Foundation of Illinois today held its first ever telethon to raise money for the arthritis treatment and research. Today's telethon was broadcast over Channel 60 from the Brickyard Mall, where I was joined by Peter Carl, Dick Kay, Otis Buchanan, Paul Hogan, and Mary Laney from Channel 5. Every 33 seconds, someone is diagnosed with arthritis, but now there's more hope, because locally, we raised over $70,000 in just 9 hours, and the national total was $2.2 million. Unfortunately, in raising the money, I lost my voice.
But
Mark,
you did a great job.
We're real excited about it.
That's great. Got a lot coming up tonight, Deborah. Good news all the way around in sports. The White Sox managed to salvage a big win before Boston got out of town, and the Cubs tie for first place by beating the Bucks. Take it to Three Rivers, where Steve Trout was in control again, going six innings to earn his third victory of the year against one loss, teaming with Stoddard and Smith for a solid five-hit performance. Sixth inning, Gary Matthews pounds a shot up the middle. Ryan Sandberg scores to give the Cubs the 2-1 win. Now it's off to New York for that first-place showdown. Back here at home, Ron Kittle belted a pair of homers, good for five RBIs, including this controversial shot on the roof. The two-run blast is ruled a fair ball, and that sends Ralph Houk through the roof. Sox win 6-4. NBA playoffs today. The Knicks front office of Eddie Donovan and Dave DeBusch are looking on in disgust as the Celtics go to work. Kevin McHale with two of his 25. Boston whips the Knicks 110-92. In Milwaukee, Stan Albeck does it again. His Nets on a playoff roll. Alton Lister just gave it to Michael Ray Richardson. He takes it the other way. The Nets beat the Bucks 106-100. Coming up on Sports Sunday, the entire day in baseball, the NBA playoffs, the USFL, plus golf and tennis, and a detailed look at Tuesday's NFL draft. Of course, as far as the Bears are concerned.
All right. Thanks a lot, Mark. Finally this evening, the Super Bowl of the latest nationwide rage was held in Chicago today. The first official Trivial Pursuit Championship was held over at the Hyatt Regency. 200 contestants sweated over 6,000 trivia questions like this one. See if you can figure out the answer to this question.
Who appeared on the May 1951 cover of Modern Screen priced at 15 cents?
Marilyn Monroe.
Close. Ronald Reagan.
Nice try. The winners were from our area. They are Dennis and Elaine Patriani of Clarendon. They came out on top, and as a result, they won a trip to Europe. Pretty good stuff.
Trip to Europe.
That's the news this Sunday night. Stay tuned next for Marchie and Greco's Sports Sunday. Thanks for joining us, and have a good week. We'll be right back.
Snapper riding mower has a patented cutting unit designed to create a powerful vacuum action, which means you can start early in the morning during high moisture conditions and get a smooth, even cut. With the optional 30-bushel bag and wagon, you may be able to mow your entire lawn without stopping to empty. The High Vacuum Snapper Riding Mower, the fast, easy way to keep your lawn beautiful.
See your Yellow Pages under Lawnmowers for the Snapper dealer nearest you.
Here come cars designed to move.